Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Lovely to see you all here. It's lovely to be able to meet together today. And just today we're starting a new series looking at the Book of Revelation. I don't know if you've ever, let's just take a quick show of hands. How many people have actually read the Book of Revelation from start to finish? Yeah, about four or five. Who's read little bits of it? A few people read little bits of it. It's one of those books that a lot of people find very hard to read for a number of different reasons. There really are some brilliant passages in it. So, for instance, it's in the Book of Revelation that you find, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. Whoever hears my voice and opens the door, I'll come in to that person, they will be with me." It's a glorious promise from God. Also, it's in the Book of Revelation that we read, "You are worthy, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honour and power, for you created all things. By your will they existed and have their being." It's also in the Book of Revelation that you read in chapter 7, verse 9, that "I looked and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation and tribe and people and language, standing before the throne and before the Lamb." It's a beautiful picture of us standing before God. And then, of course, it ends in chapter 21 with this beautiful, again, another beautiful picture of heaven, where Christ will wipe away every tear from our eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. There's so many beautiful, beautiful passages in there. But let's face it, there's also some pretty wacky ones. And so it's also in the Book of Revelation that he said, "I heard the number of those who were sealed, 144,000 from the tribes of Israel." What does that mean? Who are those people? In chapter 12, verse 3, we get a picture, let me read it for you, it's of a dragon. "Then another sign appeared in heaven, an enormous red dragon with 7 heads, 10 horns and 7 crowns on its heads." I'm like, whoa, what is that? And then also in chapter 16, verse 16, we read all the kings gathering together in a place that is called Armageddon. And you kind of think, whoa, that sounds scary. It doesn't sound good. So there's in the Book of Revelation, there's some really exciting things. There's some really confusing things and some things that we look at and are a little bit scary for us. In the next 2 months, we're going to be looking at this book, which you may think, why on earth would we do that? but as we'll see today, I think there's going to be some really wonderful, glorious passages in here. And as we're going to read through the whole of the book. And I hope that you're going to see that actually God's got a lot to say to us in it. It's a book that actually helps us to focus and see God for who he really is and how we should respond and how we can live in response to him being our God. And so one of the calls from the book, as we're going to see today, is that we actually stand before God and we praise and honour him. We're going to start off by singing in a moment with that picture of standing before God and glorifying him. But before we do that, let me pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we do thank you for the opportunity to be with your people, to gather around your word, to hear you speak to us. Lord, I ask that you be with us today as we start this new series, looking at this book that for many is very confusing and hard to read. Lord, I pray that you would bless us as we hear you speak. We pray that everything that happens today, whether it's the kids' ministry or us in church, for the talk, for the Bible readings and the prayers, that everything would work together to bring you glory. And so we commit this service to you now in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Please stand and we're going to sing our first song. Come and stand before your Maker, full of wonder, full of fear. Come behold his power and glory, yet with confidence draw near. For the one who holds the heavens and commands the stars above is the God who bends to bless us with an unrelenting love. Rejoice! Come and lift your hands and raise your voice. He is worthy of all praise. Of your King, and with trembling rejoice. We are children of the promise, the beloved of the Lord, one with everlasting kindness, for his sacrificial love.
bringing reconciliation to a world that longs to know the affections of a Father who will never let them go. Rejoice and lift your hands and raise your voice. He is worthy of all praise. Rejoice, sing the mercies of your King, and with trembling rejoice. All our sickness, all our sorrows, He's carried up the hill. He has walked this path before us. He is walking with us still. Turning tragedy to triumph, turning agony to praise. There is blessing in the battle, so take heart and stand amazed. Rejoice when you cry to Him, He hears. Voice. He will wipe away your tears. Rejoice in the midst of suffering. He will help you see. Rejoice. Come and lift your hands and raise your voice. He is worthy of all praise. Rejoice, sing the mercies of your King, and with trembling rejoice.
Please have a seat.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning, John.
Now, I've got a little challenge for you. I'm going to sing the first line in a song, and then if you know the next line, I want you to sing it too. Okay, you reckon we can do that? So I'll sing the first line, you all sing the second line. Okay, we ready? Fruit salad.
Yummy, yummy.
There we go. I knew you'd know that one. Now, that is a song that we sang at Junior Jivers the other week. And so I thought I'd mention that today because I want to tell you all about Insight, our youth group for teenagers. Why am I sharing a Jivers song when I'm trying to talk about Insight? Any ideas apart from the two who go to Insight? Any ideas? Why would that song be relevant to Insight? Yes, Archie? It does keep your insides healthy. That is a good idea. But it's a little bit more tricky than that, so I probably should just tell you. It's because at the moment at Insight, we are talking about the fruit of the Spirit. So whilst we did sing that song at Junior Jivers, at Insight we're talking about fruit, but not apples and oranges and things like that, although I am using a lot of those in my graphics at the moment. We're talking about something that comes from Galatians chapter 5, where it talks about the fruit of the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit is what we all have if we have Jesus' Holy Spirit in us. And I thought today was a good day to tell you about how at Insight we're going through all these different things like love and joy and peace and patience and gentleness and kindness and self-control and faith, all these sorts of really good things that we all have because we have the Holy Spirit in us. We might not realize we have them. We might need to try a bit harder at showing them. But we all have them if we have Jesus' Holy Spirit in us. But I thought I'd mention that today because today is the day in lots of churches where we remember Pentecost. Pentecost is that day when the Holy Spirit first came on all the believers. Does everyone know that story? When all the believers were gathered together in a room, it was after Jesus had died and come back to life, and he'd hung out with his disciples for a while, and then he went up to heaven and he said, "Wait in Jerusalem until I send the Holy Spirit." And so quite a few days later, the Holy Spirit finally came on a particular day that was called Pentecost. And ever since then, all of God's people, when they put their faith in Jesus, we have the Holy Spirit, God's own Spirit. Jesus' own Spirit is in us, which means Jesus himself is always with us, helping us to live his way. And that's the sort of thing we're talking about at Insight at the moment. I thought it might be fun to share with all of you what we're doing with the youth group. So youth group Insight, it meets on Friday nights. We have between 15 and 20 kids who come along, and they all go to high school, which is pretty exciting for them. And we come along on Friday night and we have lots of fun. And I'll do a quick quiz. Emily and Lily, do you enjoy coming to Insight? There you go. I didn't pay them or bribe them to say that. That was just spontaneously bursting forth from them. We have lots of fun games, but we have some really good discussions about what the Bible says. And at the moment, we're talking about each of these things that are part of the fruit of the Spirit and how we can show them more in our lives. And it gets quite tricky talking about things like patience, because it can be hard to be patient with people, or self-control, you know, when it's really late at night and that next episode is coming on in 10 seconds as you're binge-watching something. And do you have the self-control to say stop and go to bed, or do you keep on watching? All those sorts of things. So keep praying for Insight. And I've got one more question for you. Hands up if you think at Insight we should sing Fruit Salad by the Wiggles this Friday. Hands up. Okay, well, we'll definitely have to do that then, not just to junior jivers. And it is something I always find. Teenagers are always way too cool to do any, you know, little kid things. But if you just do it with them, they love it. We might do that this week. Okay, for kids at church and little kids at church today, this is one of these weeks where lots of people are away, and so we're a bit short on numbers. So both groups are going to be in the cottage today. Elena and I and Emily and Lily, we're going to be all in the cottage. The big kids will be in the room with the table, and the little kids will be in their normal room over in the cottage. So we're all going out together. So why don't we head out and let the grown-ups do what they're going to do. I reckon when we're not here, they sing Wiggles songs too.
Excellent. Well, as John said, we're a little bit light on today. We've got a few people away at various things, but it's great to have so many people here. And it's great to be able to come and meet with your people, with God's people. And just to remind ourselves that no matter how many people are here, how many people are watching online, we're actually part of the family of God. And I'm going to encourage you to stand with me as we encourage each other with the words of the Apostles' Creed. So what are the things that you believe? We believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. We believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. On the cross, he descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is now seated at the right hand of the Father and will come again to judge the living and the dead. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Apostolic Church, the fellowship of the saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and a life everlasting. Amen. Please have a seat. Because today we actually have a privilege. You've got a great privileged position today. Today you're getting two sermons, which I know everyone's going, yes, that's fantastic. Well, they're kind of two sermons. They're two kind of introductions because, as I said, today we're starting a new series looking at the book of Revelation, and I thought it would be very helpful for us to get a bit of an idea of the background about how to read this book before we actually look at it. And so what Graham is giving out, I'll actually email this out as well, but you might find this helpful, just a bit of a background about how you actually look at, how you read the book of Revelation, some things to keep in mind. I'm going to pray, and then hopefully by that time we'll be ready to go. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for all the amazing things you do for us. We thank you particularly for your word. And we pray, Lord, that as we look at it together, that you would help us to understand it, to apply it to our lives, so that we might worship you, that we might follow you with everything we are and everything we do. encourage and strengthen us, teach us today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, I wonder what you think about when you think about our world. How do you think about our world? It's a pretty beautiful place, isn't it? When you consider the rainforests and the snow fields and the beaches and the sunshine, the animals, it's just so many beautiful things in our world. And there's so many things to enjoy. There's family and friends and good food and holidays. It's the birth of a child. There's just so many great things that we can celebrate, and we do celebrate together in our world. But of course, you don't have to look too hard to realise that our world is not just always a bed of roses, is it? Life can be difficult. We all experience personal tragedies at one point or another, but also there are worldwide tragedies, aren't there? We think about the thousands of people who have died as a result of the COVID pandemic, or the tsunami that hit Tonga earlier in the year, which caused millions of dollars of damage and killed four people. The floods that hit New South Wales, that similarly killed four people, but did even more damage, $2 billion plus in damage. Or indeed the tropical storm that hit the Philippines in April, causing a landslide that killed 123 people. There are terrible things that happen in our world, aren't there? But they're just the natural disasters. Think about all the kind of man-made disasters that there are around the world. Of course, we've been reminded again during the week about the seemingly constant stream of schoolyard shootings in the US. We've just passed 100 days of the war in Ukraine, which has been tragic. But of course, there are other parts of the world that we don't hear about in the news so much, where there are other humanitarian disasters. So Yemen, for instance, is a country that's been at war for 7 years, and three quarters of their 29 million people are in need of humanitarian aid. It's incredible. And the DRC in Africa, there are 27 million people who are in need of some kind of food aid because of disease and violence. There's terrible things that are happening in our world, and they're just a few of them. As if that's not hard enough, as if that doesn't make you feel bad enough, consider the way that our world is becoming more and more anti-Christian, more and more antagonistic towards Christianity. You know, previously long-held Christian moral values are being jettisoned one by one from our culture. There seems to be a long-running campaign to get scripture out of schools, to get God out of our public institutions and out of our holiday celebrations. Anything to do with God is kind of marginalised and pushed aside. You can't stand up and speak, or you're not allowed to pray within a certain distance of abortion clinics, those kind of things. There are all sorts of things coming in here, but that's nothing, again, compared to real persecution that's happening in places like North Korea and Afghanistan and Nigeria and Pakistan and many other places around the world. I bet you're glad you've come to church, aren't you? But there's so many difficult things in our world, aren't there, that can make it not such a wonderful place to be. Now, if you've got that picture in mind of our world, I want you now to try, if you can, to put yourselves in the shoes of a first century Christian. Because yes, they experienced all the kind of natural disasters and problems that we have, but they also had a much lower life expectancy and a higher infant mortality. But again, much worse than that, as if that's not bad enough, for Christians in that age, the first century was a very difficult time to be a Christian. Christians were ostracised from their families, they were prevented from social advancement, they were arrested, they were beaten, they were stoned, they were crucified, they were burnt at the stake. Like, terrible things were done to Christians in that age. Now, if you were one of those people in that time, how would you feel? How would you keep going? I mean, if you knew someone who was going through that and you were going to write them a letter, what would you say? What could you possibly say to help people keep going in the face of that kind of opposition? And if you did write a letter, what kind of letter would you write? Imagine if you're writing a letter to somebody in North Korea today. Could you just write about the gospel? Could you write about Jesus? Or would you have to try and put it in some kind of code so that it could get through and that they wouldn't get into more trouble? Well, the reason I share these kind of things is not to actually make you feel depressed, but actually to give you a bit of an idea of what it was like to live in the first century, particularly to what it was like in the world that the book of Revelation was written into. As I said at the beginning, this book is one of those books that people find very hard to read. A lot of Christians are scared of reading it. And some people, there may be some people here today who are thinking, why are we bothering to look at this book? Because it's just so weird and wacky. People have all sorts of really strange ideas. All the fruitcake element within the church have a field day with this book. And then, of course, it's just plain hard to understand. Like some of these images and stuff in there, it's just so hard. But despite the fact that it is quite difficult, it's actually, I hope you're going to find that in the next few months, you're going to be really encouraged and strengthened by this book. I hope it's going to challenge you. It's going to challenge all of us, I think. But it's a really important book for us to look at. And there's a couple of reasons. And they're actually in the first three verses. This is the first three verses of the book of Revelation. Let me read it to you. The revelation of or from Jesus Christ, which God gave to show his servants what must soon take place. He made it known by sending his angel to his servant John, who testifies to everything he saw. That is, the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. Blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy, and blessed is the one of those who hear it and take to heart what is written in it, because the time is near. So there are a few interesting, important things to notice from those couple of verses. The first thing is that this is the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. This book is God speaking. So when we read these passages, it's not just some wacky dream that somebody, as somebody had said to me this morning, that was written by someone that had too many magic mushrooms. These are words from God. The Holy Spirit wants to speak to us. Jesus wants to speak to us. And so surely that's something that's worth listening to, isn't it? It's worth exploring and thinking through. But not only that, it's also important because it's talking about things that must soon take place. He's talking about the fact that our world is not always going to be like this. I was at a conference during the week that reminded us how important it is for us to live our lives with remembering the end. Remembering the fact that Christ is going to return one day. And that, because that will have a huge impact on the way we live. And this book talks about living in the light of the end. In fact, we've called this series The Beginning of the End. Not because we necessarily think the world's about to end tomorrow, but because that's what this book is about. It's talking about preparing us for the end. And the third reason I think it's important for us to look at this book is because it tells us how good it's going to be. Blessed are those who hear it and take it to heart. And so I hope as you read this book and as we study it together, that we will indeed be blessed. God's got some great and really encouraging, wonderful things to say to us as we read this book. And so I hope that you will find those things here. But just as an introduction, so this first little talk is just an introduction to the book. Those of you who don't know, this book is written, as we say, to the seven churches, what we'll hear about in a little while. The seven churches are here. I don't know if you can see them up there. They're in what we call modern-day Turkey, or actually Turkey, like it's now called. Turkey, is that what it's called? I don't know how it's pronounced. I'm not very good at that. To the seven churches that are there. And John himself is now on the island of Patmos, which is, he's in exile there. He's been arrested for being Christian and sent off. And this is what Patmos looks like, something a little bit like that. It's just a small island. And John is kind of imprisoned there, and he's writing to the churches. He wants to write to them, he's writing to these very difficult circumstances, because when you face difficulty, there are two possibilities. You either give up your faith because it's just too hard, or you end up your faith being strengthened as you learn to trust in God. And John wants to encourage the latter and protect them from the former. He wants the people he's writing to hear these words and to be strengthened in the face of great difficulty. And not to give up. And so to achieve this end, he actually wants to show them that there's more to life than what we can see. That's why it's called Revelation. You may think that it's the total wrong name for a book, because to reveal something means to make something clear or make it obvious. But what John is doing for us is he actually is going to pull back the curtain, if you like, on our world. Because when we look at the world, what do you see? We see the terrible things that I've described earlier. The natural disasters and the human disasters that happen and all those kind of difficulties, the persecution that there is. And we see all those difficulties, but and we can get so caught up in looking at those things. But what John is going to do is he's going to pull back the curtain for us and just help us to realise that there's something bigger going on here. There's a much bigger picture that we need to be aware of. There are spiritual realities that we need to understand if we're going to survive in this world. And to do that, he uses a style of writing that we don't really know. It's called apocalyptic. The word apocalyptic just means revelation. It's like an unveiling, if you like. And we know what it's like to have different types of writing, don't we? I'm not an English teacher by any means, but I know there's different types of writing. So you could have poetry, there's prose, there's recounts, there's fiction, there's non-fiction, there's balance sheets, there's cartoons, there's editorials. There are all sorts of different types of writing, aren't there? Different styles. And each of those different styles have different rules that govern them. And so if you're writing poetry, that you might have a kind of rhyme or rhythm in your as you write it. And you might use kind of word pictures or metaphors and similes, that kind of thing. If you're writing a balance sheet, you don't have too many similes or metaphors in a balance sheet, do you? You just have columns and numbers and all that kind of stuff, and you put your income and then your outgoings. And there's kind of rules that regulate it. And so today, we're going to be looking at this apocalyptic literature for the next couple of months, actually. And apocalyptic is a type of writing that uses a whole lot of word pictures. To give you an idea, I've had a vision that I want to share with you. This is my vision. It's not from the Bible. This is just a vision, an important one that many of you will come to realise how great it is. I looked, and before me I saw a battlefield. And on that battlefield, I saw a wild cat, an African deer, a single red rose, a rooster, a man dressed in black, and a small hopping marsupial. And behold, they did wage war until all but two remained. The man in black and the rose went into battle until finally the rose stood on the head of the man in black, whose tail hung between his legs. Does anyone know what that vision is about? Has anyone ever watched the rugby? This is a vision about next year's World Cup. You see there a battlefield, and you see all the nations come. They were the small hopping marsupial that didn't even make it to the final. Of course, the English rose stands victorious over all of them. That's the prophecy. You can take that and do what you will with it. It's a vivid dream. It's true. It's always a tragedy being an England supporter, let me tell you. Anyway, but for those who didn't really understand, who knew nothing about rugby, all those images of Springboks and pumas and roosters and roses, men in black, is meaningless. But for those who understood what the images were, well, it started to make sense. We're on a battlefield and here they are fighting one another until one of them comes. It's picture language used to get across an idea. And that's what we see in the book of Revelation. It doesn't just tell us things, but it uses this kind of pictorial language. And the reason it does that is the same reason that people write love songs. Now, you could write a love song that says, yeah, I think you're okay, and you're really nice, and will you marry me? You know, like that. That's maybe not the best love song in the world, okay? People write love songs, they put it to music. Why do they do that? Why do people do that? Because it's beautiful, because music is not just, it doesn't just hit your mind, it hits your soul, hits your heart, it moves you. That's one of the reasons why we sing songs in church, not just because we want to remind each other to rejoice, come and lift your hands. Like we sing it because it actually moves us in a way that mere words don't. And so one of the reasons that the book of Revelation is written as it is because it's trying to hit our hearts. Because we live in a world that's hard, that challenges us right at the core of our being. And so this book is going to write using language that's going to actually stir us, and it's going to blow us away. And it's going to, I hope, it's going to encourage us. And so if you've got this sheet of paper that was handed out, let me just walk you through just some of the few things that are important to keep in mind. I'm not going to read the whole thing, but just a couple of things to keep in mind when we're reading any apocalyptic literature. Okay? The first one, and there's lots of lovely alliteration in here, so I hope you appreciate that. The first thing we need to do is to consider the context. the context of the things that are around it. So there are two contexts that are really important for us to remember. The first one is the historical context. So John writes this in the first century, where he's underneath the power of the Roman Empire. He's off in exile. Christians are being persecuted. If we're going to understand this book, we really need to understand the culture that he's writing into. And he's going to use some images that we're going to be able to fit in with some of the things that we see at that particular time. The other context that's worth keeping in mind, of course, is the biblical context. Although this is a vision, a dream that God has given to John that he's written down, it's not just some random thing that's just come out of nowhere. A lot of the images that are used in this book come straight out of the rest of the Bible. And as we're going to see a little bit later on, we're going to see that as we look at chapter 1 together, that he actually pictures up some of the images from Daniel chapter 7. So there's the context. It's really important. And we'll pick up these things as we go along, but it's really important for us to keep in mind. The second thing for us to keep in mind is how we can crack the code that is written in. Because let's face it, it's not the same as the kind of letter that you would write to your friends, right? We don't usually write like this, but apocalyptic literature has particular styles and particular images that it uses. And we're used to this kind of idea. For anyone who's written using emojis, people write emojis in their text, which are like little smiley faces or whatever it is. That's a symbol, an idea that's meant to get across an image, gets across a message. And that's what Revelation does for us. And it uses different symbols as teaching aids. So, for instance, it uses numbers. And so throughout the book, we're going to see a whole lot of numbers. And they represent different things. So the number 12 represents God's redeemed people, like the 12 tribes in the Old Testament and 12 apostles in the New Testament. The number 1,000 is just like, it just represents a vast number beyond counting. Because, of course, in the first century, they didn't have gigabytes and terabytes and things. They didn't count by the millions. The things that they had were, you know, how many sheep do you want? Oh, I'll have 100, please. They have 1,000. Like, to have 1,000 is just like beyond counting. And so that image, the number of 1,000, just represents a huge number. The number 7, as we're going to see in a moment, is a picture of, it's a divine number. And so it symbolises God or completeness. And so this letter, as we can see in a moment, is written to the 7 churches. Now, of course, there were more than 7 churches in Turkey at the time, or in Asia Minor, let alone across the rest of the world. There were way more than 7 churches. But when he says it's written to the 7 churches, it's talking about God's church, talking to the complete church, the whole church. He also, it uses numbers, uses objects, and we can see all sorts of strange objects and symbols. So eyes, for instance, there'll be people with eyes covering their bodies or their wings. It's just a picture of knowledge. And the more eyes you have, the more knowledge you have. Similarly, horns. Horns are a picture of power. And so again, the more horns you have, the more powerful you are. Crowns are a picture of rule and authority. So we see numbers, we can see objects, we can see animals being used. Animals like the lion, which is a picture of nobility, or the ox, which is a picture of strength. The eagle shows speed, or the lamb talks about helplessness. And so we're going to see animals throughout the book. We're going to see different colours used. And so the colour of white is a picture of purity, but also a picture of victory. The colour red is a symbolic of blood and pain. The pale grey that we're going to see in the pale rider in a few weeks' time is a symbol of death. And so colours are used. And so there's all sorts of symbols throughout this book that are meant to convey an idea. And for us to understand the book, we don't expect to see dragons with 7 heads, for instance. This is a picture of something that John is trying to get us across to us, and we need to understand what those symbols are representing. So we need to consider the context. We need to try and crack the code, and we'll do that as we go along. We need to try and learn the layout. Revelation is one of the books in the Bible that's most closely and tightly structured. And we're going to see as we go through, and you can see on that sheet there's a very deliberate structure of this book. And depending on which passage you're reading, it's important to work out where in that structure you are. It will help you understand what's going on there. And we'll explain more about that as we go along. Next thing is to perceive the parallelism, which is a weird word. But basically, in our world, there's no such thing as black and white, is there? There's no such thing as black and white. There's only shades of grey. So there's no right and wrong anymore. But what John wants us to see as he pulls back the curtain is he actually wants us to realise that in reality, there is black and white. There are really two kingdoms. There's the kingdom of God and then there's the kingdom of this world, the kingdom of the devil. There are only two realities. There's God's kingdom and then there's the other. And so there's all sorts of contrasts and comparison between the godly version, like the New Jerusalem, and then the Babylon. So these things are kind of set up against each other. So there's parallelism, it's very hard to say, that's there, that's really helpful for us to see. And the last thing we need to realise is we need to recognise the revelation. We mustn't forget what this book is called. It's a revelation. God is trying to reveal something. There are spiritual realities that we need to understand. And sometimes people can get so caught up in the minutiae or the details of this book. What exactly does that number mean? Or what exactly does that horn represent? Or that crown represent? Or who is this person we're talking about? But actually, if we do that, if we spend too much time focusing on that the detail, we'll actually miss what it's all about. It's a bit like this. Does anyone recognise this picture? It's a very famous picture. Why not? It's a little bit blurry. Look, I've got as close to it as I possibly could. I want you to see it really, really clearly. Well, how about if I do this? Does anyone recognise that picture? Okay. That's the picture of the garden, Monet's garden, of course. It's a beautiful picture. One of the things about Monet's paintings and a number of other paintings is if you get too close to it, if you zoom right in and focus on the little dots and dashes and splashes of colour, you're not going to really understand what's going on. It's not until you actually stand back and take a look at the big picture that you actually understand what's going on. And so I think the book of Revelation is a little bit like that. Sometimes there will be times when we'll think, well, this is a little bit hard for us to understand. What's going on here? What does this say to us? And when you're in that situation, one of the things that's helpful for us to do is to take a step back and to see what's going on in the big picture here. And so as we go through this book, through the book of Revelation, as I said, it's very structured, and we're going to be taking passages, some big slabs of passages at times, so two or three chapters. There are a couple of times we look at two or three chapters. And the reason we're doing that is because we are going to look at some of the detail. We'll zoom in on some of the details here and there. But we're also going to be trying to look at the big picture of what he's actually trying to say in those passages. And as we do that, I think we're going to see that actually God's got some really exciting and wonderful things to say to us. So I hope you really enjoy this series. I hope you really are moved and excited by it. World's longest introduction. We're actually now going to have our Bible readings. And then we'll come back for, I promise you, a shorter talk on that day's passage. So I'm going to invite Jenny and Lorna to come and read for us.
So our first reading comes from Daniel chapter 7, verses 9 to 14. And it's sort of halfway through one of Daniel's dreams. So chapter 7 starting at verse 9. As I looked through, thrones were set in place, and the Ancient of Days took his seat. His clothing was as white as snow. The hair of his head was as white like wool. His throne was flaming with fire, and its wheels were all ablaze. A river of fire was flowing, coming out from before him. Thousands upon thousands attended him. 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The court was seated, and the books were opened. Then I continued to watch because of the boastful words the horn was speaking. I kept looking until the beast was slain and its body destroyed and thrown into the blazing fire. The other beasts had been stripped of their authority, but were allowed to live for a period of time. In my vision at night I looked, and there before me was one like the Son of Man, coming with the clouds of heaven. He approached the Ancient of Days and was led into his presence. He was given authority, glory, and sovereign power. All nations and peoples of every language worshipped him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that will not pass away, and his kingdom is one that will never be destroyed.
The second reading is the whole of the first chapter of Revelation. The revelation from Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants what must soon take place. He made it known by sending his angel to his servant John, who testifies to everything he saw, that is, the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. Blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy, and blessed are those who hear it and take to heart what is written in it, because the time is near. John, to the seven churches in the province of Asia, grace and peace to you from him who is, and who was, and who is to come, and from the seven spirits before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood, and has made us to be a kingdom and priests to serve his God and Father, to him be glory and power for ever and ever. Amen. Look, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him, and all peoples on earth will mourn because of him. So shall it be. Amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. I, John, your brother and companion in the suffering and kingdom and patient endurance that are ours in Jesus, was on the island of Patmos because of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. On the Lord's day I was in the Spirit, and I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet, which said, write on a scroll what you see, and send it to the seven churches, to Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamum, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. I turned around to see the voice that was speaking to me, and when I turned, I saw seven golden lampstands. And among the lampstands was someone like a son of man, dressed in a robe reaching down to his feet, and with a golden sash around his chest. The hair on his head was white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were like blazing fire. His feet were like bronze glowing in a furnace, and his voice was like the sound of rushing waters. In his right hand he held seven stars, and coming out of his mouth was a sharp double-edged sword. His face was like the sun shining in all its brilliance. When I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead. Then he placed his right hand on me and said, do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am the living one. I was dead, and now look, I am alive for ever and ever, and I hold the keys of death and Hades. Write, therefore, what you have seen, what is now and what will take place later. The mystery of the seven stars that you saw in my right hand and of the seven golden lampstands is this. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands are the seven churches.
Alrighty. So if you've got that passage, we'd like to keep it open in front of you. And we're going to look just at the second half of it. We're going to look from verse 9 on to verse 20. As I said before, John is writing, and he's writing from the island of Patmos. He said, we hear that it says, I, John, your brother and companion in the suffering and kingdom and patient endurance that are ours, was on the island of Patmos because of the word of God. So John has been arrested. He's been sent off into exile onto this island, this prison island, if you like Port Arthur or something like that. And he's suffering, like the rest of the Christians he's writing to are suffering. And what he wants to do is that God's got something to say to the church through him. And he gives him this vision. And so at night he's there, and he hears a voice behind him, He says, a loud voice like a trumpet. And again, remember, it's not that it is a trumpet. So he doesn't say... It's the power and the majesty of a trumpet speaking. And so this voice speaks to him and says, listen to what you say. Share this, what you're about to see, with these people. And so he says, I want to see who's saying this. And so he looks around and he sees 7 golden lampstands. Now, it's not because he's accidentally in his dream walked through IKEA or something. This lampstands represent something. I don't know if you heard it at the end of that passage. Did anyone pick it up? What do those lampstands represent? The churches. That right. He's writing to 7 churches. There are 7 lampstands. It's the picture of God's church, remember. Again, it's not just to these 7 churches. And so we can validly read these passages. These are for us. It's to God's church. So as he looks around, he sees these. That's the first thing he sees, the church, the symbol of the churches. But then that's not the thing that really grabs his attention. That in between all those lampstands is someone who looks like a son of man, he says. And when you look at it, when you hear it described, it's like, wow, it's like he's walked straight out of Doctor Who or some kind of science fiction thing. He's got stuff blazing out of his eyes and he's got swords coming out of his mouth. It's like grotesque. What's he trying to... Who is this guy? Well, to understand it, again, we need to, as we said before, we need to be aware of the context of where this comes from, the biblical context. And so to really understand this passage, we need to understand another one. We need to go back to that first reading that Jenny read to us from Daniel chapter 7. Daniel chapter 7 is the start, actually, of the second half of the book of Daniel, which actually is, in many ways, the beginning or the birthplace of the apocalyptic style. And so as you read through the rest of Daniel, you'll see, the first half's got Daniel in the lion's den and Shadrach, Meshach and Abednego and all those great stories that we teach the kids. We don't usually teach them the second half because it's just a bit wacky, a bit hard for them to understand. But in chapter 7, you get this amazing vision. Daniel has this amazing vision of 4 beasts that that are violent. But then at the end of this vision, he sees... something else. And this is in verse 9 and 10. Let me read it for you. I'll read it again. It says, as I looked, thrones were set in place, and the Ancient of Days took his seat. His clothing was white as wool, white as snow. The hair on his head was white like wool. His throne was flaming with fire, and its wheels were all ablaze. A river of fire was flowing, coming out from before him. Thousands upon thousands attended him. 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The court was seated and the books were opened. What is that a picture of? It's a tricky question. Who do you think is the one sitting on the throne? It's God, of course, isn't it? He's described as the Ancient of Days. In other words, before the days were, God was. He's always been and always will be. It's a picture of the Ancient of Days, and we're given a description of him. And again, it's using this kind of picture language. So he's wearing clothing that's white as snow. It's not just that he's been using bleach or something like that. He's got the gown of authority, the gown of a king, and his white hair, which nothing wrong with white hair. It's lovely. His white hair shows forth his authority and his purity, his perfection. And then there's a throne of was flaming with fire. It's a throne of judgment, because we're actually going to see the books come out in a little while, because the books of judgment. And on this throne, it's got its wheels. So what's this throne? Why has it got wheels? Is it just like some kind of like a shopping trolley? You know, God can get down the IGA trials aisles easily. No, it's not for that, because it's the idea of wheels is the fact that it travels. And that wherever God wants to go, he goes. And the judgment just goes everywhere. It's a picture of God's judgment not just being in one place, but in all places. And so that's what the river of fire is that fire of judgment that's coming out. And there's people gathering around to praise and attend him and worship him. It's a picture of God on his throne. But a little bit later, there's another vision. The vision develops and someone else appears. I really want to focus on this person. Verse 13, in my vision at night I looked, and there before me was one like a son of man, sounds familiar, coming with the clouds of heaven. He approached the Ancient of Days and was led into his presence. He was given authority, glory, and sovereign power. All nations and peoples of every language worshipped him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that will not pass away, and his kingdom is one that will never be destroyed. Now, who is that a picture of? Of course, it is. As we look back now, it's a picture of Jesus. For Daniel, he had no idea who that was in this vision. Somebody has come before God, and this person has come and seems to have some of the qualities of God. He's brought before God. He comes on the clouds of heaven, which he's come from heaven. So how can that be? And he's a son of man. Like, he's not God, but he's a son of man. And yet he's given authority to rule. He's a kingdom that, and all nations will bow down before him. His kingdom will never, ever end. And indeed, when people bow down before him, they will worship him. Which, when you think about it from an Old Testament perspective, is absolutely outrageous. Like, what's the first commandment? You shall have no other gods but me. You shall worship no other gods but me. And yet here, we've got this Son of Man coming before God, and every tribe and language is bowing down and worshipping him. How can that be? Who is this? For Daniel, it must have been an incredible mystery. But when you turn to Revelation chapter 1, it becomes clear. So in Revelation chapter 1, if we skip back there, we see the Son of Man appear. As soon as we hear that word Son of Man, we think, this sounds familiar. Is it the same person that we see in Daniel chapter 7? And as we look at him, we see some very familiar things. Look at the way he's clothed. He's wearing a robe of white with a golden sash around it. It's the same robe that the Ancient of Days was wearing. That robe of authority, of purity, of perfection. He's also got white hair, which, as we know, is perfect. But it's a picture of purity and authority. His feet, he's got blazing eyes. So instead of having a river of fire around him, like comes out of the throne of the Ancient of Days, his fire comes from his eyes. He's got these blazing eyes. The eyes of judgment. He's got bronze feet, which are the bronze of battle. The bronze is an image of warfare and strength. And so he's a conqueror. This Son of Man comes as a great conqueror, and he speaks in this loud voice, this powerful voice. In the same way that God spoke at Mount Sinai, and the earth shake and the people tremble with fear. That's what this is what this guy speaks like. When he speaks, the earth shakes. And as he speaks, he's got this in his right hand. He's got these mysterious seven stars, which we're told later are the angels or the messengers. The word for angel is the same as the word for messenger. It's the same word. And they're messengers. They're going to be messengers to the seven churches. There's seven churches, seven messengers. Because as we're going to see in the very next chapter, he's got seven messages to these churches and to us. And so his loud, thunderous voice is going to speak through these messages, and it's going to be a voice that actually brings judgment. Because I know that because the comes out of his mouth is a sharp, double-edged sword. As we see in the book of Hebrews, that double-edged sword is the word of God. God is going to speak, and he's going to rule by his word. And finally, he's got this short, light tongue, and he's got this bright face, which reminds me a little bit, again, of Moses. You may remember when Moses goes up Mount Sinai, he comes back down, and people don't want to look at him because his face is shining. It's reflecting the glory of God. But the difference with this guy is he's not reflecting the glory of God. He's shining it. So his face was like the sun shining in all its brilliance. See, this is not someone who's been in God's presence and is glowing. This is God. God himself is here. The king has finally come. There will be no other rulers to rule. He is the one before whom every knee will bow. That's what was promised through Daniel hundreds of years earlier. And now John is saying, here he is. You know, sometimes we have we picture Jesus in very earthly terms. We've been looking at the last few weeks, haven't we, in the book of John. We've seen him go to a wedding and talk to people and walk along the road and have people talk with him. And he's like, you're talking to me. That's how we picture Jesus. And rightly so, because he was a human and did great things. But what John is trying to do here is trying to pull back the curtain and show us Jesus for who he really is. This is something we must never forget about him. Jesus is, he was and he is God. He is the first and the last, he says in verse 17. Just as God says in verse 8, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last. Jesus is the one who was there at the very beginning, and he will be there at the very end. And he's the one who will stand in judgment over all people. And if you live in a culture, if you live in a world that seems to be out of control, it's all these powerful kings and rulers and presidents and emperors and whoever it might be, who you think, well, these people are just the ultimate power, we actually need to pull back the curtain and realize the truth that Jesus is the king. He is the true king. And we need to recognize that. And one day everyone will recognize that and fall before him and worship him. And what's more, not only is Jesus big and powerful and glorious, not only is he God, but look where he is. Where is Jesus? When he turns around and looks, is he up on his throne, far and distant, ruling over everyone? Is that where he is? Where is he? He's standing amongst the lampstands. The churches are there and Jesus is there with them. Wherever they are, whatever they're doing, whatever they're going through, Jesus is there. You may remember Jesus' final words to his disciples in Matthew 28. Does everyone remember them? Chapter 28, verse 20. I am with you always to the very end of the age. John wants us to realize, Jesus wants us to realize that no matter what it looks like in our world that we live in, the reality is that Jesus is the King and he is with us. So how do we respond to this? Well, there's three responses very quickly I want to look at. The first one is John's response. What does John do when he sees this? In verse 17, he falls down and like a dead man. Just like Moses does at the burning bush. Just like Isaiah does in chapter 6 when he stands before God and says, woe to me, I'm a man of unclean lips. Unfortunately, sometimes in our desire to make God approachable, we sometimes forget to realize that he is somebody who's worthy of worship. The appropriate response from John is to bow down and worship him. And what is when he's down there, what does Jesus do? How does Jesus respond to what John does? Does he kick him while he's down? Does he say, well, as you should be, on your knees before me, kiss my feet or wash my feet while you're down there? No. What does Jesus do? He leans down, it's beautiful, and he places his right hand on me. He says, do not be afraid. Don't be afraid. I am the first and the last. I'm the living one. I was dead and now look, I'm alive forever and ever. And I hold the keys of death and Hades. Not them. I do. Don't be afraid. I am with you. I am God and I am here. You do not be afraid. Don't need to be afraid. So what do we do with this? Well, our response, there's two things. And I hope you can remember and pick up these two things from this beautiful passage. The first one is to realize who it is when we think about Jesus, who we're talking about. We need to recognize that we come to worship the King. We don't follow a dead political religious leader. We follow the most magnificent, glorious King of the universe who is all-powerful, all-knowing, completely pure, completely wise, before whom everyone will bow one day. That is who Jesus is. It is an honor and a privilege for us to come to him. And when we come before him, when we sing his praises, that's the one we should be singing to. We mustn't forget who Jesus is, and like John, we should fall down and worship him. Secondly, we need to realize that this all-glorious, all-powerful ruler is with us always. No matter what we're going through, Jesus is here. I said at the beginning, and it may start off seeming a bit depressing, that life is hard sometimes. And as you read through the book of Revelation, it doesn't pull any punches. It tells us that life is going to be difficult. Because it is. There's no promise that Christians are just going to sail through life and everything will be hunky-dory. Life is going to be hard. But in the midst of that, the constant theme in this book is that God is there. Jesus is there. Jesus is with us no matter what. And you can trust him. Don't be afraid. Let me pray. Dearest Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for sending your Son, Jesus, to rescue us, to save us, to live for us, to give us life. Lord Jesus, we praise you because you are the King, you are the Lord of all. And Lord Jesus, we thank you because we don't, even though that is true of you, we don't need to be afraid of you because your love for us is so great. You reach down and you say, do not fear. Lord, for those here who are here tonight, today who are feeling afraid, who are feeling the weight of the world on their shoulders, Lord, may they see you for who you really are. And may they know your arms wrapped around them, your hand of comfort on them. Lord God, give us peace, give us strength that we might endure in this world of suffering. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. In response to what we've heard from God's word, will you join with me as we sing this beautiful song, Christ is mine forevermore.
My soul, for his love is mine.
come rejoice now, O my soul, for his love is my reward. Hear his call now, hope is sure, Christ is mine forevermore. And mine are keys to Zion's city, where beside the King I walk. For there my heart has found his treasure, Christ is mine forevermore. Christ is mine forevermore. Christ is mine
forevermore. Be seated, and we're going to move into a time of prayer. Before Jenny comes and brings our prayers and our requests to God, will you join with me as we confess our sins to our Heavenly, loving Father? Together. Heavenly Father, we praise you for adopting us as your children and making us heirs of eternal life. In your mercy, you washed us from our sins and made us clean in your sight. Yet we still fail to love you with all our heart or serve you as we should. Forgive us our sins, renew us by your grace, that we may continue to grow as members of Christ, in whom alone is our salvation. Amen. Although we come before God and confess our sins to the Holy One, he reaches down with his right hand, says, "Do not fear, your sins are taken away." Jenny's going to lead us in prayer.
With this week being Reconciliation Week, I'm actually going to start with an acknowledgement of country that Neville Naden, the Bush Church Aid Indigenous Officer, has written. So let us pray. We acknowledge the Triune God, the Creator of heaven and earth, and his ownership of all things. We recognise that God gave custodianship of these lands upon which we meet to the First Nations people of this area. In God's sovereignty, he has allowed other people groups to migrate to these shores. We acknowledge the cultures of our First Nations people and are thankful for the community that we share together. And may our respects to the elders and leaders, both past and present, and those who are rising up to become leaders. Today, God, we bring to you and our people in our church who are really struggling. We particularly pray for Gina, her family, friends, and members here in our church community for their grief. And we also pray for those who are not well and who are troubled. And you remind us in Matthew 11, 28 and 30, to come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. We pray, God, that we can be refreshed in your presence, especially when we're feeling burdened and weary, that you can give us rest and restoration, and build our spirit by praying and talking to you, but also listening and waiting for you to speak into our hearts. We also pray for our church community and for wisdom for the parish council meeting on Monday evening, for our leaders Steve and Lorna and John and Fiona, our Bible studies, our children and youth, and all our groups. And we lift up to you our new Australian government and Prime Minister, Anthony Albanese. May they all look to you for direction. And we continue to pray for a peaceful outcome for the war of Ukraine and other unsettled countries around the world. Strengthen those who are spreading the gospel throughout the world and Australia, particularly the Tamani Industries in Kenya and Simon and Jess Cow in Italy and Andrew and Liz Glover in Cambodia, especially in their last 2 weeks. for James and Brittany Damon in Mudgee, and Shaq in Nara, and Wiki with Quebec in Coyama, and Anglicare working in our local communities. Thank you that you have perfectly crafted a yoke that fits us all, that we leave our burdens at your feet, and that we can take up your yoke for our lives each day. We ask this in your Son's name. Amen. Join with me and we say the Lord's Prayer together up on the screen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Well, we've just about come to the end of our service, but just a couple of quick announcements before we finish. The first one is a reminder for all the seniors here that there's a clipboard at the back to sign up for the next Explorers outing on the 27th of June. So if you could sign up for that, that'd be really great. And it's an opportunity to bring our friends and family, bring friends out that we know, contacts, neighbours, whatever, to come and join us. So please, please start thinking about that and who you might invite to that. Graham, did you want to say something about next week? Do you want to come and do that quickly?
Okay. Next Sunday, my daughter Rebecca and her husband Andrew and their boys will be here. Some of you have met them before, but they're going to be sharing at each of the services about their plans for the Middle East, where they're hoping to go sometime in July next month. They've spent nearly 10 years on and off in Thailand as missionaries doing sports ministry, and they planned 2.5 years ago, in fact, to go across the Middle East, but it's been held up. But the plan is now for them to come and to take them on as some missionaries. So they'll be at the services next Sunday, but also on the Monday, which is a public holiday, of course, we're going to have probably an early afternoon tea. It'll be in the bulletin next week, about 1 till 3 o'clock, where they can speak a bit more detailed and perhaps a bit more openly about some of the plans that the Lord has for them in the Middle East. Thanks.
Also coming up, obviously this Thursday is the funeral for Peter Carl, what's happening, there's going to be a celebration Thanksgiving service over in the hall, in the town hall, at 11 o'clock on Thursday morning. There's actually going to be a small service for the family, funeral service for the family here earlier that morning, but for everyone else, the Thanksgiving service will be over at 11 o'clock. And the family's asked us if you have one and are able to wear your, if you've got one of the Jesus Is shirts or badges or whatever, if you've got one of those at home, to wear those, because Peter used to love wearing his around. You probably realise that. And so if you're able to wear that on Thursday, that would be a great way to honour him. The one last thing is to do with, there's two more things. One is to do with the roster that's coming up for term three. Michelle's getting into it nice and early, which is great for next term. And so at the back there, there's two clipboards for our congregation. And it's got a list of all the people who come to the 10 o'clock congregation. And if you'd like to be involved in any kind of ministry, if you haven't been involved in one, this is a way to get involved. Or if you are involved in one, or you're involved in too many and you feel like you need to pull back, on those clipboards, if you could just, on one of those clipboards, you can tick which of the ministries you'd like to be involved in. Okay, so if you want to do morning tea, tick under morning tea, and so on. But also, the other clipboard has the dates of term three. And so if you could indicate the dates when you're not around to be on that roster, that would be a great help as Michelle puts the roster together. Okay, so grab one of those at the end, that would be fantastic. The last thing is that the new prayer diary is out, and it's available at the back. And a lot of them have got the names on them, so grab yours. We've asked people, if you're able to make a donation of $10 towards the diary. If you can't do that, that's fine, or you don't want to, that's okay. But Beth is at the back. She's got an FWOS machine. That you can deposit straight into the church account if that's the best way, or you could, cash is fine too, but that would be really helpful. I think there might be any last things. Okay, before we sing our last song, I believe it's before we sing our first last song, is Oh, no, it's after. We'll do that. Okay, let's stand. And we're going to sing our last song. See if you can pick any of the words from this song. It's one we did last week. So we thought we'd do it again because as a way of consolidating it. But a lot of the images also come straight from Revelation 1. See if you can pick them as we go through.
Glory and power to the one who loves us, honor and praise him forever, come Lord Jesus, come Lord Jesus. Glory and power to the one who freed us from all our sins by his blood, come Lord Jesus. Come, Lord Jesus. See him coming on the clouds of heaven. Every eye behold him now. He's the living one, the first and last, who once was dead, but now he lives of heaven. Every eye behold him now. He's the living one, the first and last, who once was dead, but now he lives forever and ever. Jesus is the living who died and came alive. Jesus is Almighty Lord, who was and is to come. Jesus is the living one who died and came alive. Jesus is Almighty Lord, who was. Coming on the clouds of heaven, the eye behold him now. He's the living one, the first and last, who once was dead, but now he lives. See him coming, the clouds of heaven, every eye behold him now. He's the living one, the first and last, who once was dead, but now he lives forever and ever, forever and ever.
Let's remind us ourselves of the grace of God that is with us as we say this grace together. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. Thanks for joining us. Let's have some morning tea together.